Hi, I'm Glyn Jewett, and I want to let you know about my brand new book, Photograph Like a Thief. Now, I truly believe that your own unique style starts with copying, because you have to have a starting point. But when I say copying, I mean looking at the work of other great photographers, their lighting, composition, posing, how they retouch their images, learning from it, and going on to create something completely new. Now, I've packed a lot into this book. There's a whole chapter dedicated to reverse engineering, equipment, my favourite retouching techniques, and 10 chapters taking you from coming up with an idea, the lighting, the setup, the photo shoot, and the complete retouching steps from start to finish. So check out Photograph Like a Thief, available now where all good books are sold.
Hello, YouTube. Had a few technical glitches there at the start. I've been practicing it all day trying to get this ready, and then when I go to click start streaming, all the reveal keys have actually all been disappeared and all my keyboard shortcuts have gone. So I'm going to be doing this all kind of manual tonight. So as a guy multitasking, this is quite some task. But thanks very much for coming along. Hopefully you guys can hear me. If you can hear me, I know there's a little bit of a delay, just give me a comment in the comment section on the live stream. I'll just make sure that everyone's there, they can hear me, and then we can kind of crack on. It's kind of weird seeing yourself on another screen and the delay that comes through. But what I want to do tonight then is just take up a little bit of time. I don't know how long this is going to take. I usually say about half an hour, but it always goes over because I can talk for England. But I basically want to tell you a little bit about my brand new book, Photograph Like a Thief. I want to kind of explain where the idea came from. And if you stick around to the end, I've also got actually a brand new Photoshop technique to show you. I haven't even done a video on this, I only found out about it last night. So if any of you have been looking at my YouTube stuff lately, when I talk about colorizing your pictures using lookup tables and how effective they are and how quick and easy they are to use, I think I've got an even better way of using color now, and it doesn't even involve lookup tables. I think you're going to really like it. It is for those of you who are on the Creative Cloud, because it's a really clever way that you can use your Creative Cloud library to be able to add color to your picture. It's absolutely brilliant. Just hang around to the end. Also, extra little thing to let you know about, if I can dive over on the top on the screen now, you can see just above me, just here, there's a code, and that's thief 40. Now, that's a 40% discount code that my publishers Rocky Nook are offering. It's up until the 8th of this month. So if you want to get the book in any format, that'll be the printed version. Everyone loves printed versions, or the digital version, then go to rockynook.com, and when you add the book to your basket, there'll be a place where you can put the discount code in. So you put thief 40, it'll take 40% off. Now, I know from the previous book that I had out, some folks ordered it before it was released. Some folks in the UK ordered it before it was released in the UK. They ordered it from the US publishers, and it arrived incredibly quick. So it might be, if you can't wait, and I really hope you can't wait, if you can't wait, go to rockynook.com. No matter where you are, place the order there, you're going to get 40% off. And even if the discount doesn't kind of work out to a discount with the delivery, hey, your quid's in anyway. That's how I kind of see it. But that's just me. Okay, so I want to take you through then why the book was called Photograph Like a Thief. And then maybe just a couple of little things at the end, Q&A, and that particular Photoshop technique I want to show you. The bonus thing is we've got the Thief 40 code there. Also, if you leave a comment, I've actually had a failed delivery from a courier today, so I think my books have arrived from the publishers from the States. So I'm going to have a load of books here. I'm going to give away a book from tonight. So if you leave a comment in the comments section, I'll pick one after the live stream. I'll get in touch with you and I'll send a book. Doesn't matter where you are in the world, I'll send a book out to you, because that's the kind of guy I am. But let me just dive over to the presentation I'll give you now. And I actually want to do it with me on the screen as well. So let's have a desktop and webcam. There we go. So let's just bring up the presentation. Here we go. And we'll just press play on that. There you go. So you can still see me in the bottom. Now, Photograph Like a Thief. It was generally, I will get to comments, by the way. I'm trying to multitask here, but I will get to comments. Canada, Carolyn Stampdean. Nice one. We've got Canada in the house. The book originally came from an idea having read this book here. Now, if you haven't read this book, this is called Steal Like an Artist by an incredible author called Austin Kleon. And this book, it was kind of like a light bulb moment for me, because I don't know about you guys, but I guess all of those of you who are out there, either photographers or retouchers, or to be honest with you, in any creative kind of world, when I first started out, I was told that I had to have two things. The first thing was I had to specialize. Now, this is mainly for those of you who are looking to make money from this, okay? I had to specialize. But also, and they said this as if it was really easy, you've got to have a style. And it's like, well, how on earth do you get a style? Because I don't know how many people we've got in the room at the moment. It's actually pretty good numbers there. Out of all of us that are in this room at the moment, this virtual room, how difficult would it be to get a style that would separate us from somebody else? Very, very hard. But it was kind of said as if it was easy. Now, the thing is, when I was doing this particular style, or trying to get my style, I got this book, and there's a few quotes I'm going to put on the screen here. They're not from me, they're from pretty wise people. But look at this one here from Sir Henry Ford. He says, "I invented nothing new. I simply assembled the discoveries of other men behind whom were centuries of work. Had I worked 50 or 10 or even 5 years before, I would have failed. And so it is with everything new." And that kind of says it. That's the other famous quote that he had. The other one was when he said, "You can have any color car you want as long as it's black." I kind of like that one. But reading these kind of quotes that came in this really easy to read book here by Austin Kleon, it kind of made the light bulb go on for me, because before then I'd always been told you can't copy. You just cannot copy. If you want to be a photographer and have your own unique style, you cannot copy. But my kind of feelings is, how on earth do I get a style if I can't even have a starting point? That's the kind of thing that I was always talking about. So how can I get a style if I don't even know where to start? So I kind of started thinking about it in different ways. Again, thankfully, because of this book here. Now on the screen, you're going to see, you know, famous four here, the Beatles. Now, when the Beatles first started playing, they didn't have their own kind of particular style. They were going around all the working men's clubs. They were playing in the Cavern in Liverpool, you know, getting some real good gigs there. But they were actually doing copies of other works. They were doing cover versions from people like Jerry Lee Lewis, Elvis, and so on and so forth, Buddy Holly, and you name it. It was only when Paul McCartney said they decided to write their own material so they could have their own gig that they then started to get their style. And I think I'm pretty right in saying that you put a Beatles track on, even without them singing, you know it's a Beatles track. But how do they start? They started by copying. So it's okay in the music world, but not in the photography world. There's a sharp intake of breath when people even suggest copying in the photography world. Another example, this record here, which I'm guessing you would have heard of, really famous song, Every Breath You Take, by a band called The Police, who are around in the kind of like 80s, that kind of thing. And there's a really famous guitar riff, really, really famous. Now, that famous guitar riff was then used in another track by an American rapper called Puff Daddy, and he created a song called I'll Be Missing You. So he'd taken that famous guitar riff, put it into a track that he was writing, a brand new track, and made something completely different. Now, the problem with this was he didn't actually ask permission to take that guitar riff, so he's not made any money from it, but that's by the by. But what I'm saying here is, what's happening is they're taking something that they like from that music track, putting it into another one to make something completely new. So why can't we, as photographers, maybe do the same? Maybe there could be something that we like about another photographer's work. It could be their lighting, their posing, their composition, even the way they retouch their pictures. Why can't we look at that, take something from it, and then use it in our own pictures to make something new? And that really is the whole idea behind Photograph Like a Thief. But let's just kind of move on a little bit. Cooking. My wife is an amazing cook. I can go to the cupboards in our kitchen downstairs. I'll open the cupboards up and I'll be like, looks like it's beans on toast tonight, love, because I can't really see anything. But my wife will go to the same cupboard, open it up, and she'll turn up with a three-course meal. I don't know how she does it. She's an incredible cook. But when it comes to cooking, here, I mean, you can go to any bookstore and you'll see countless shelves filled with cookbooks. And what do these cookbooks give you? They give you the ingredients you need. They give you the exact step-by-step that you need to create this wonderful meal for your family. But even though you've got all the ingredients and you've got the step by step, how often does it not end up looking like it did in the book? Now, the reason I say this is because no matter how much you try to copy, you can't. And there's a famous movie director who actually said that we actually want you to copy from us because you can't. I can't think of his name at the minute. I'll post that up in the comments afterwards. But I also, when I first started out, I started writing a blog, not because I had any followers. It was purely as a way of me getting out to have kind of like an impetus to get out. I'd say, right, I'm doing one blog post a week. Every single Wednesday, I will do a blog post. Not because I wanted to have lots of followers, but it really kind of forced me to kind of make sure that I got out and made some content. Because otherwise, it may be the same for you, that you can go a day, a week, a month, 2 months, maybe even longer, when that really nice expensive camera bag with that really nice expensive camera kit inside it hasn't even seen the light of day. So by me setting one day a week when I'd go out and do a blog post, it forced me to get out and start experimenting and learning. Now at the time, my portfolio, if you looked at maybe 10 pictures in my portfolio, they could have been from 10 completely different photographers, but that's not the point. It was kind of getting me out to actually do stuff. All right, so let's move on. Now, so we're talking about copying. I'm hoping you kind of agree here that copying is good. We're not talking about what I would say plagiarism, not trying to make an exact replica of a picture. What we're talking about here when we're copying or stealing or thieving, what we're talking about here is taking something that you like from a picture and then putting it into your own picture, all right? So what I started doing was I started using Pinterest, which is another social media site. But what I started doing was creating boards, and you can see one of them on screen now. This is one of my favorite photographers in the whole world, Annie Leibovitz. I absolutely love the work that she does. There's a real certain kind of look about it, which I really do love. She's obviously very lucky working with A-list celebrities and stuff, but maybe one day. But what I started doing was collecting pictures from people like Annie Leibovitz and putting them into a board on Pinterest. So these were pictures that I kind of, something about them that I really liked. I couldn't maybe put a pinpoint on what it was I liked, but there was just something I liked about it. So photographers that I really like looking at their work are people like Annie Leibovitz. You've also got somebody called Mark Seliger. He's the guy that does all the incredible A-list celebrity portraits after people have had their Oscars. So they come off the stage having given their acceptance speech, they come around the back, and then Mark Seliger and his team have got an amazing set. They come down, takes a picture of them, and away they go. And he then shares these on Twitter and Instagram. Incredible photographer. So I love his work as well. But I also keep a board by random photographers that I really like. Inspiration ideas. So there's all kinds of people, like Dan Winters will be one. Joey Lawrence from America will be another one of the kind of people that I put their work into here as well. So now, if I just show you this picture here, this is an example now of how I would thieve something from a picture that I really liked and then use it later on. Now, this is a picture by Joey Lawrence. He's the guy who was, I think he was 18 when he photographed the advertising material for the Twilight series of movies. 18 years of age, insane, but an incredible talent. But this picture here was a pitch that he did for the Killing Lincoln. It's like a docudrama, I guess. It was on the National Geographic Channel. When I saw this picture, I really liked it. There was something about it I really liked. The first thing I would say would be the pose, the way that these two people are posing. Absolutely love it back to back. You wouldn't normally see that for two people, but also the lighting, I loved it. Now, at the time, I was working with a kickboxer. A guy called Stephen Cook, based in Aylesbury in the UK. He became world champion, and for a good few years he'd had a lifelong coach by the name of Michael Graham. And one day Stephen had contacted me to say, Glyn, I'd love a really nice picture, a really cool picture of me and Michael together, because, you know, something that a great picture, an iconic picture that in years to come they can look back on and remember the times that they had helping Steve to become world champion. So, you know, no pressure there, but I kind of said, definitely we'll do it. And then I dive into my Pinterest boards and I start looking through some of the pictures I've got. When I saw this one, I was like, that is the picture we've got to do. So rather than me trying to explain it to Steve, I text him the picture and say, Steve, this is the kind of thing I think we should do. He then knows exactly what my thinking are. I'm not sort of saying that we'll get you dressed in black coats and we'll grow a moustache and stuff. None of that. Just the posing and the lighting I thought would really work. Steve was definitely game on. So We then have to think about, right, how, if I'm going to do this, if I'm going to steal the lighting from this and create a new picture, I need to know how to reverse engineer it. And reverse engineering is a big chapter in the book, Photograph Like a Thief book. It's a big, big chapter, because it's okay saying you want to take something from it, but if it's lighting, you need to know or have a rough idea, not exactly, but a rough idea how the person did the lighting to create that picture, first of all. So let's take a look at this one here. We look at this character on the kind of right-hand side of the frame. We can see clearly that there's a light coming in from the side there. We can see it on his face. However, there is also, on the shadow side of his face, there is this kind of like triangular pattern of light underneath his eye, kind of like Rembrandt lighting. So maybe then, and again, this is all explained in the book, maybe there's a light coming in from the side, and it's going to be slightly forward. I explain more of this in there, but the actual light source is going to be further forward of the person. So maybe, you know, kind of nearer to the photographer. And the reason for that is the light needs to see this side of the face, which has got the light on it, but it also needs to see this side of the face. So to see here, the light needs to come forward so that light sees past his nose and can light here. Does that make sense? So that's that one light there. And we'll say that this was an octa of some sort. Okay, so now let's look at the Abraham Lincoln character. He's kind of side onto the camera. He's got a really nice profile light, very even profile light going down him from the head, down to his hands, and then down to his legs. So let's just say, for argument's sake, that this is a strip box, possibly with a grid, so that the light doesn't spill everywhere, but it's very, very directional onto him. So we'll say there's maybe two lights. One from the side to the front on the guy on the side. I keep pointing with the pattern of his light under his eye, and then the other strip light on the Abraham Lincoln character. Now these guys are wearing black, so there's also detail. I hope you can see that on your screen. There's quite a bit of detail there, so maybe there was also a third light, or even a reflector, maybe above the camera, something like that, just to kick a bit of light into those details. So now that I've done, kind of worked it all out, I then go and do a diagram to say, right, this is how I think it was possibly lit. You can't see the reflector that I used in this one here, but you can see the position of the octa. And you can see now what I mean about that octa being further forward of the subject so that it does actually light this shadow side of his face. Now, I have got a video on my YouTube channel. I'll make sure that I put the link in the description there, where a very good friend of mine, I photographed a man called Brian Dukes. He was kind enough to model for me when I went through showing him how we can do that particular lighting. So I'll link that video in there so you can check that out. So this is using Sci-Light, a great little app that you can use on your phone for doing lighting diagrams. So then we take that. So now we know. We've got the pose we want to use with Steve and Michael. We know the lighting. I then go to the studio and we start to set it. Sorry, studio, not the, we go to the gym. We're on location now. We then go and set it up how I think Joey Lawrence would have done his original picture. So I take it. You can see here the lighting being used in the particular picture. And then I use that to create something new. Do you see what I mean by kind of taking something from another picture and putting it into a different one of your own to make a completely new picture? I don't know who it was who said it to me a long, long time ago now. They said there is nothing new in photography. I guess you can't really argue with that. So that's one example there. Now, here's a great saying here from somebody called Salvador Dali. Pretty wise person, definitely wiser than myself. And they said, those who do not want to imitate anything produce nothing. I can't say it really clearer than that. But again, not from me. Came from this book. I cannot recommend this book or this book, certainly this book, I can't recommend it enough. It really will help you if you're struggling to get ideas, how you can get your own style and so on and so forth. That's a great starter, but this one here, Photograph Like a Thief, you want to go for that one as well. All right, so let's have a look at another quick example. Here's a great picture. This is by Annie Leibovitz. Typical Annie Leibovitz kind of picture here with the texture in the background and the lighting. We've got Sir Patrick Stewart and Sir Ian McKellen. Now, I get this picture, I put it into my Pinterest board as a maybe one day this will come in handy. And sure enough, it was. A group of guys contacted me called the Bearded Villains up in Manchester in the north of England. They wanted to be photographed. And these guys are really, really sharply dressed. One of them is a very good friend of mine called Mac. And these guys, if you imagine now, they've got big beards, nothing like this. This is a feeble effort, but we're talking proper big beards now, manly beards. So they've got those, but they're also really sharply dressed. So they wear the flat caps, got really nice press shirts, the waistcoats, the fob watches. I mean, really sharp. If you've ever seen a program called Peaky Blinders, you'll kind of know what I'm on about when it comes to how they actually looked. But so I see this picture. I get asked to take their photographs. I then dive into Pinterest and I see this picture. I think that would be a great starting point. Not to be the only picture we do, but to be a really good starting point. Because what I don't do for definite is tell people, oh, we're going to get loads of pictures. I'll go, right, we're going to work on this picture. It helps me to get much more focused. Whereas before, I used to get so stressed out saying, oh, yeah, we'll get loads and I'll send you a disc. Well, not a disc, you know what I mean, a memory card, or maybe I'll WeTransfer you or Dropbox you a load of pictures. But that to me was stress, serious stress. If I just say we're going to work on one picture, when you get it, you always get more pictures anyway. But just go there focused on getting the one picture. But this one here was a prime example of one that I wanted to use as a starting point, photographing the bearded villain. So, like I said before, if you're going to copy something or steal from it, you need to know how they actually did it. So let's have a look. Let's examine this now. So Ian McClellan, we've got light on that one side of his face. His other side of the face is also in shadow, but you can just about see underneath his eye, there's a little bit of light. So now maybe we're looking at something very similar to the previous picture with Joey Lawrence and the Abraham Lincoln. Maybe something like that Rembrandt cross-lighting kind of thing. So that's possibly, we'll say that's how Sir Ian McClellan has been lit. Now, let's look at Patrick Stewart. He has got light on the equivalent side of his face. So the light's coming in from one side, hitting Patrick Stewart's face. And then on the other side, whoops, there we go. On the other side, it's in shadow with a bit of light under the eye. So maybe, just maybe, one light has been used to light both of them. I mean, they're quite close together. We can talk about inverse square law. So the light's positioned just far enough away so that when it comes off and goes across their faces, they're evenly lit. They're within that area where the actual exposure is pretty even. So let's just say it's one light. So now we're talking about reverse engineering here, right? We're talking about highlights and shadows and stuff. You may be thinking there's lots of other ways we can look at reverse engineering. One of the ways is using catchlights. And again, I do cover this because it's quite a big chapter. The problem with catchlights is that people like me, and maybe some of you folks who are retouchers and do a lot of work in Photoshop, maybe you can move those catchlights. So although probably 90% of the time you can trust it, there's that little 10% that puts a little seed of doubt in your mind that maybe that's not the original shadow catchlights. Because sometimes I know people move them. They might move them around. They might have two catchlights in the one eye and go, oh, I don't like that. So they get rid of one. So you can't really trust it. But we'll just say, for argument's sake, that in this particular picture, Annie Leibovitz, she hasn't affected the catchlights. This is how they are. So you can see they're kind of coming in from this kind of position here, which would really kind of make sense with what we've talked about already, with the light being to the side, to the front. And this one now is going to be slightly up and angled down onto Sir Patrick Stewart and Sir Ian McClellan. So I take that. And then I go to the studio up north to photograph Mac and Sam, the two guys from the Bearded Village. And you can see here, grey background behind, grey paper, by the way, is a huge, huge thing to have in your kind of kit bag. Well, not your kit bag, but to have some grey paper. There's so much you can do with it. You can actually fake the look of having one of these really expensive canvases. And I've got videos on that, again, on my YouTube channel. But you can see here with the light, I'm using an Octa. Can you see how it's from the side? And it's slightly forward of both Sam and Mac. So I use that to then create this particular kind of picture here. Now, that's actually looking quite saturated on the screen there. It's not quite so saturated, but you can kind of see the pose that we've worked with here. It gets us off to a really, really good start. Now, similar lighting. This is a group shot. I won't go into too much detail about this one, but again, it goes to show that when you kind of start using a particular style of lighting, and that's one thing I would suggest you do as well, choose one style of lighting. Me, I love one light, that Rembrandt cross lighting kind of thing. So I'm sticking with that for a while. I really do like it. And then just do it again and again and again. It was Joel Grimes said to me a while ago now, if you're going to have a project and you're going to choose a style or try to get a style, do the same kind of lighting at least 20 times. So it just becomes a habit. That way, when you do the lighting, you're not even thinking about it. Now, the technical side of it, well, that's easy. You're doing what you're able to do and what you should be doing as a photographer, which is communicating with the person you're photographing. That's what it's all about, really. The technical side of things should be just, you don't even have to give it a thought. It's the actual bringing the character out, which really makes the photographs. But take a quick look at this one here. Large group. So we've gone from pictures of two people to now we've got pictures of 12 people. But the lighting is exactly the same. It's just further away to the one side. So we've got light coming across from the from your screen. It'll be from the left-hand side, quite some distance away. Again, we're talking inverse square law there. And it's gone off and it's lit the people up and they're all within an area where the actual exposure is fairly even. But it just goes to show how you can actually you can actually take a picture, which was something pretty dull and boring, like this one here, because this is what we actually had to deal with first of all, because the studio, the location we used wasn't really all that good. I wanted to be photographing these people at Downton Abbey. We ended up in a studio that's used for photographing cars. But the main thing is getting the lighting correctly. And because I practiced it again and again and again, because I'd stolen it from people I really like Annie Leibovitz, the lighting was absolutely no problem. But the actual picture here, to take it from this out of camera shot to this, I kid you not, and I'm not just saying this, I maybe 10 to 15 minutes maximum. We cover that picture in all the detail in the book. So you don't just put the flooring in the background. There's also little things like you're changing people's tires and darkening down their shoes and so on and so forth. All the little things that take time, but the majority of the heavy lifting, if you like to do this picture, you could easily do within 10, 15 minutes. Absolutely no problem. I don't care how much experience you've got in Photoshop. As long as you can make the most basic of selections, you can do that really easily. So here's one. This is from a fashion designer. Again, a really cool quote that was in Steal Like an Artist. A guy called Yoji Yamamoto. Start copying what you love. Copy, 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 copy. At the end of the copy, you'll find yourself. Now, that's getting really kind of heavy, but I totally get what he's saying there. Because I kind of equate this to when I first started out, there were certain people whose work I really, really loved. And I still do to this day really love it. People like Joel Grimes, absolute legend. I love his work. Another great friend of mine, a guy called Calvin Hollywood, a digital artist based over in Germany. So I would see their work and I would try to copy it again and again and again. Not because I wanted to make an exact copy, but I just really liked what they did and I was kind of drawn to it. Now, as I did it more and more and more, I remember one particular time, one guy posted online when I was really proud of a picture that I posted up, and he put a comment in there saying, oh, that looks just like Calvin Hollywood's kind of style. And I just know that he'd said that in a way that was not meant to be a nice comment. Do you know what I mean? It was kind of putting me down. But put it this way. If I've got a photographer whose work I love and they're really kind of getting out there, they're really doing great stuff. If somebody says to me, or maybe even to you, oh, that looks just like such and such a person, it's not going to make me feel bad. It's actually going to make me feel pretty damn good. Do you know what I mean? Because I'm like, wow, you're saying that this is just like his? Excellent. I must be doing something right. But the thing is, you see, when it comes to copying, you'll never get it exact. You'll never get it exact. When I'll go back to this thing when I mentioned about starting off doing a blog, right? Started off doing a blog. Now, one of the things I also started doing was when I did this blog, and this is relevant, I would pick, once a week, I'd pick a photographer whose work I really, really liked. One of those guys in the very early days was a guy called Tim Wallace. And you've heard of Tim. He's an incredible car photographer. He's now doing private jets and all kinds of amazing stuff. But I spoke to Tim, got him interviewed on my blog, and I asked him a question about style. How do you get a style? And Tim said to me, you can't force a style. And it was getting really kind of heavy. But he says, you can't force a style. A style just happens. But your style basically comes from your likes, your dislikes, your taste, your upbringing, your life experiences, and so on and so on and so on. So you can't force a style. Now, you'll never see in my portfolio a white background and children with, you know, multicolored balloons clapping in the air and laughing. You'll never see that. There's nothing wrong with it, but it's just not my style. I guess my upbringing, my life, my likes, my dislikes, things that have happened to me have influenced really what I kind of like. And my pictures have got, I guess they've definitely got a certain kind of mood into them. Not because I'm moody, but there's a definite kind of mood into them. I also remember, and I go off on track sometimes, I used to be a competitive bodybuilder. And I remember I got to about 19 stone, which I think for those of you working pounds, 276, something like that. And I remember that as I was getting really, really big, some people would make the comment saying, oh, are you taking steroids? And I know they were saying it in a way that was kind of derogatory. But initially, it kind of got really upset me because I was thinking, hold on a second. I'm at the gym at crazy times in the morning, every single day of the week. I eat, sleep, breathe, the whole thing so that I can develop this body. And you're saying the only reason I get that is because I'm taking steroids. So initially, it did used to wind me up. But then I kind of flipped the coin on its head and I thought, well, hold on a second. What do most people, what do the general public think steroids do to you? Not the rude thing, but what do they generally think they do to you? They make you big, right? So if somebody's saying to me, oh, you on steroids, what must they think? They must think that I'm big. So that's how I kind of turned it around, thinking, well, yeah, game on. Yeah, well, I'd say, no, I'm not. But, you know, I appreciate you asking. But obviously it means I'm big. Do you kind of get what I'm saying here about the copying and how you can't copy? Well, anyway, let's move on. Right, anyway, this picture here. Now, I'd love to tell you that this is a portrait that I took of my ultimate hero, Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'd love to say it was, but I'm afraid it's not. It's actually an action figure, not a toy, but an action figure. They're called Hot Toys. And I actually got the idea from doing this because although I want to practice consistently, get, you know, to get better and better and better, sometimes it can be hard on a rainy day to get a model, okay, somebody that you want to photograph. So I thought, well, I could practice doing this. I could actually practice with a hot toy. And I got the idea from this from a really incredible artist, a guy called Glenn Melling. If you've never seen any of Glenn's work, definitely check out Glenn's work. He's incredible. But I got the idea of photographing miniatures, which is what he does. So you can see here, now I've talked so far about my favourite lighting style that I've taken and I'm now using in my own work to create new images. Now, although I've used it on a big scale, you've seen it with one person, you've seen it with two people, you've seen it with a group of 12, you can also use it as a miniature because it kind of translates everywhere. So if I kind of move over here, you can see now, look, I'm tethered, we've got Arnold there, we've got the camera on a tripod, tethered into the Canon software, just so you can see it coming through on the screen. But can you see that little modifier? Just like a bit of material. That's by a company called Rogue. That's a Flashbender XL, Flashbender 2 XL Pro. And it's like a miniature softbox that you can put onto your flashlights to create the kind of lighting that you would do on a big scale in the studio. But can you see from the picture, if I go up to this one just here now, can you see how the lighting is the same as what we talked about already? Light on one side, patterned light on the other. So the more you do it again and again and again, you just get so incredibly comfortable with it. It's just, this is what it's all about, getting the actual technical side of it done by copying so that then when you come to taking the pictures, working with that person is absolute second nature and so, so easy. Now, I thought I'd show you this one as well because I did say, in fact, Glenn said to me once he'd seen this picture I did of Terminator or the Arnold Schwarzenegger thing, he did say you'll want to buy another one of these toys or action figures. And I said, no, I won't. But I did. I ended up buying this one after I'd seen the Man of Steel movie, which I absolutely loved. So I went onto a website called IMP Awards. If you've not seen it, check it out. It's impawards.com. On there, they've got, you know, so many pictures from movies from the past, present and future. All the artwork that was done. Now, I don't tell you that so you can go and copy a movie poster, but it's a great place to go and look at things like how do they pose people? That could be really quite hard, right? But look at movie posters. You know, there'll be pictures of two people together, one person on their own, there'll be groups of people. You can, you know, take these pictures, put them onto a Pinterest board called posing so that you can then start to refer back to it to get ideas for how you can pose people. See, all this kind of copying, this thieving, the idea is that it's going to really help you to develop your own particular style. So get these pictures, put them in there, get the grey matter going and get ideas for poses. But it's a great website, impawards.com. But you can see here, I saw this picture on IMP Awards of the Man of Steel movie poster. Absolutely loved it. The only reason I did this was for a bit of fun. Trying to step out of my comfort zone, have a little bit of fun, and get myself thinking, how would I do that? That's one thing I really love, is forcing myself to think, how would I do that? So the picture I wanted to recreate was when Superman's kind of hovering in the air with a bright light behind him and the clouds and all this kind of stuff. So I put two lights, you can see on the screen now, two lights to create a rim light, and then I went on to create this picture here. Just for a bit of fun, stepping out of my comfort zone, copying a picture, trying to recreate it. This isn't a portfolio piece. This isn't the kind of work that I want to get employed by, you know, clients and stuff like that. But doing this kind of stuff here helps me to learn new stuff, but it also keeps me excited and interested, which is the reason I got involved in this in the first place. Does that make sense? All right, so let's move on just quickly then. Dad's Army. If you've never seen this film, I highly recommend it. I love it. It's based on a comedy series that was around, I believe, in the 70s, I think it started, maybe late 60s, early 70s. It's all about a thing called the Home Guard. And the Home Guard were people that were either too young or too old to sign up and go and fight for their country during the war, World War II. So I saw this film and I thought I'd love to do a picture series. And we're talking a long-term project now based on the Home Guard. I've got a massive interest in World War II. I've got an uncle who's an author, has written books about World War II and people's medals and all this kind of stuff. I've always had an interest in it. So I really wanted to do this because I want to keep that memory alive of what went on and what people went through. So I spoke to a friend of mine who said, you do realise that locally to where you live, when I live just outside of Oxford, there's a group called the Oxfordshire Home Guard Living History Group. So I contacted those folks, I ended up going to photograph them. And this is a project now that's just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And because of the kind of pictures I'm taking, I'm getting different work because of it, because I've now got this particular style that people seem to recognize. So you can see here, this is Brian. He's the leader of the Home Guard group. Same lighting as before. One light from the side, that octa, nice highlight on one side of the face, and that pattern light on the other. So I'm using it. Can you see now what I mean? I'm taking something originally from something like Annie Lee, which I really like, and I'm using it in my own pictures to create new stuff. Let me just show you a few more from here. This is Peter, the same kind of style, same kind of lighting. But what I really like about this is when you start to develop your own particular kind of style and your lighting, and that just happens, by the way, style just happens. But when you get a lighting style that you really like and you do it again and again, you'll realize you can actually do it not just indoors, but also outdoors. So this picture here of Chris, who's the dispatch rider, exactly the same lighting. It's that octa. I was using an Elinchrom 135cm octa, or 50 inches, those of you who work in inches, with a Godox external battery pack, took it outside, exactly the same lighting. So what I was doing indoors, I can replicate outdoors. So now this is really quite an important thing, because remember I said before that when I first started, I was doing pictures and, you know, I'd do a picture one week and then another week and another week. And then if you looked at my portfolio, it could have been by 10 different photographers. By me now using this same lighting style that I really like and then doing a whole series of pictures with it, indoors, outdoors, miniature, you name it, it's becoming a recognizable style for me. So when you look at my portfolio, there is not a uniformity, but there's a definite, you can definitely tell that it's my style of lighting. Does that make sense? So it's rather than having all these different kind of looks and stuff in your portfolio, it's having a distinct look to your images by repeating that particular lighting again and again and again. So you can see exactly the same things here. I actually love photographing these people. Exactly the same photographs here. This is a photo shoot did a few weeks ago up in Cardiff. Huge thanks to my friend Anthony Cruthers, who helped me out with this, and also the staff at Cardiff Railway Station. Absolutely legendary the way they helped us out. But exactly the same lighting style and use on this one particular one here. Now, for me, these are really interesting pictures. And I was always wondering, how can I make an interesting picture? Because what I don't want to do is have somebody looking at my portfolio on an iPad and just swiping through the images like this. I want to have interesting pictures. And it was Joe McNally said, if you want to have interesting pictures, put your camera in front of interesting things. Makes sense, right? So this project for me, it's really absorbed me. So if I can do anything during this broadcast, anything at all, it's to encourage you to get one lighting pattern or one lighting style that you're going to do again and again and again. Choose it. It might be one, it might be two, it might be three. I don't care what it is, but just choose it and choose to do a project of at least 20 pictures and do it again and again and again. All right, so this was from a picture that I did at Photoshop World recently in Orlando, a couple of weeks back now. Crazy how time's flying. But an amazing couple I worked with during my first in-depth or pre-con class. Again, based on the book, we had a four-hour class. But this here, photographing this couple, exactly the same lighting. This is Dustin and Dania. Now, remember I said at the very start, I want to show you this brand new technique that I've kind of discovered last night to do with colouring, nothing to do with lookup tables. I'm going to show you on this particular picture, and it's about 1 minute long, so make sure you stick around for that. Also, used the same lighting when I was out at the professional imaging show in the Netherlands, photographing this great couple here, Stefan, who was a brilliant model to work with, and Vito. It was a real quick shot. And this literally was, we set the lighting up, they sat down, took two pictures, and they were gone. But because I'd repeated that lighting again and again and again, and this isn't me saying, oh, look at me, aren't I great? This is just a case of me saying, look, if you practice that lighting pattern again and again and again, you'll be able to just repeat it so quickly without even thinking about it. Hey, go on eBay, get yourself a mannequin head. I don't know if you can see one just up in the corner there. Can you see that just up there? That's a polystyrene mannequin head, £4 on eBay. Shove it on a light stand. And it's available to model for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it doesn't moan. You can do whatever you want on it. But if you practice so much on things like that, on a mannequin head, when it comes to having a real person in front of your camera, you know exactly where the light's going to be. So you're doing what you should be doing as a photographer, talking to the person, all right? So let's have a quick look then. This is a bit of a recap. This is a picture of Roger, just to show you again, the lighting style exactly the same, light from one side, shadow on the other with that pattern of light. And this kind of gives you a little bit of a look behind the scenes to show you where that's the grey paper. See the grey paper there, which was used to create that nice canvasy textured background. There's the octa, nice and high up, like the one with Sir Patrick Stewart and Ian McClellan. to the side, to the front, and high up to give that nice pattern of light on that side of the face. And you can see there roughly how far forward the actual particular light was. And there's another shot, and I want to finish off by saying this one here. Now, I don't know if I'm trying to multitask here, look at the comments, but does anybody know who this is in the comments? Anybody got a clue who this could be? Martin Baker, I'll definitely get back to you. You've got a nice comment there, so I'll have a look at that in a second. But, all right, this here is a picture of Arnold Schwarzenegger. Now, why the hell would I talk about Arnold Schwarzenegger at the end of this particular part of the broadcast? Well, as I said before, he's my ultimate hero. But when it comes to Arnold Schwarzenegger, look what he's achieved, right? When he's a kid, here he is now. This black and white picture is a picture of Arnold when he was a young boy in Graz in Austria at school. Now, what did Arnold dream of when he was a young boy? He wanted to be the ultimate bodybuilder, the best in the world, the most amazing physique. So what did Arnold do? Well, and I've read this in his books, he went out and he got every single piece of bodybuilding literature that he could get his hands on. Every magazine, every book, he went to every show that he could possibly go to. Everything that he could take in and ingest, he did it. Then he started to train. He used to get some weights, some old dumbbells and maybe some little beer cans filled with lead and just real roughing it kind of stuff. But he trained. But the training he got from the magazines, he would see what the legends of the day were doing, his heroes, Reg Park, Dave Draper, and they would list down, this is what I do for chest, this is what I do for shoulders, this is what I do for my biceps. And he would see how many sets, how many reps, and Arnold would do exactly the same. He'd repeat it again and again and again, and he'd just keep looking at these routines and repeating them again and again and again. And eventually, as he repeated it, he started to grow. But as he grew and he looked at these routines, he would then start to realise what worked best for him. So they would say, right, rather than me doing seated dumbbell curls, my arms grow better using a barbell. So he would then start to adapt it so that he then started to grow and change and become his own particular way of doing things, and his own style and his own physique grew from it. And I kind of put that very similar to how we are as creatives, be we photographers or retouchers. Arnold did exactly the same thing. He copied, but he realised after a while what worked best for him. And that'll be the same for you. If you go out and you find somebody's work that you really like and you try to copy it again and again, even though you can't because your likes, your tastes, your dislikes, your upbringing, so on and so forth, but the more you try to copy, eventually, without you even knowing it, your style will start to show itself. One day, someone will say to you, "Whoa, that looks just like a Mark Seliger picture, but slightly different." And you won't even see it, but other people will. So you can't force it. Just like Tim says, you can't force your style. It will just happen. But only if you keep going out and practicing again and again and again. So let me just come out of here just for a second. I hope that kind of makes sense. Let me just give my mouth a bit of a break, take a quick swig of water, and I'll just dive back over and we'll just put this commercial break on one more. Hi, I'm Glyn Jewis, and I want to let you know about my brand new book, Photograph Like a Thief. Now, I truly believe that your own unique style starts with copying, because you have to have a starting point. But when I say copying, I mean looking at the work of other great photographers, their lighting, composition, posing, how they retouch their images, learning from it, and going on to create something completely new. Now, I've packed a lot into this book. There's a whole chapter dedicated to reverse engineering, equipment, my favourite retouching techniques, and 10 chapters taking you from coming up with an idea, the lighting, the setup, the photo shoot, and the complete retouching steps from start to finish. So check out Photograph Like a Thief, available now where all good books are sold. All right, so before I show you that Photoshop technique that I keep promising you about, make a note, Thief40 is the code that you can get hold of the book in any of the formats, printed or digital. Make sure that's from rockynook.com. You can see the details there on the actual thing just above my head. But that's valid until the 8th, okay? So make sure that you try that out, because 40% off is a pretty damn good deal. The other thing, don't forget, there's some great comments and we've got some great attendance. This is only my second live broadcast, so I'm really chuffed to bits that you've joined me. But here, I'm going to get a copy of this. And you see, I am so happy with this, by the way. So shout out to Rocky Nook. They've done an amazing job with this book. And I'm not just saying that because you'd expect me to be in my book, but I am so incredibly happy with this. It's a nice, big, thick book, 408 pages. I couldn't stop writing. But the printing quality, I don't know if you can kind of see it. Let me just try and show you some of the printing quality in here. I'm so incredibly happy with it. I mean, they've done a great job. And it's a new kind of style because they've got these like little pull-out bits here, which I don't know what they're called, though. There is a name for those. But make sure that you leave a comment in the comment section. I'll check those after we've done this live stream, and I'll pick one. Doesn't matter where you are in the world, but I'll post one out to you because I definitely had a missed delivery by the courier today. So I'll get that one sent out to you. So there's that. So definitely get hold of that. The 40% discount. Still like an artist. Highly recommend it. Little book, big writing. Perfect. My kind of book. So let me just show you. Those of you still around, we've still got some great numbers. I will now dive in and I'm going to show you that technique. I will do a video on this at some point, but I want to show it to you. I've not even thought about how I'm going to do this, but let me just quickly show you this particular technique. So, right, let me bring up Photoshop. So here's, let's just change that over. So you need to see my desktop, and that's shortcut of 3. How's that? That's in black and white. Why is that in black and white? Let's just revert that. So go file, and we can't even do that. So let's just go back. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll get rid of that, and we'll dive over to Lightroom. Oh, no, hold on a second. Right, give me 2 ticks. I'm just going to turn my files on. The best laid plans of mice and men. That's what they say, isn't it? All right, so I even moved my chair over because I had a noisy chair, and the one I've moved to is even noisier. But let me just get this picture up on the screen here. I need it with all the layers in just to kind of show you. So once that's loaded in, we'll be good to go. All right, so let's go here. Make sure this all loads in. And we'll cancel that. All right, so we're good to go. So now let's just send this over, this picture here. Send it over to Photoshop. Let's bring this up. Now, if you've seen the most recent video that I've done, which is episode 109 on my YouTube channel, that's where I talk about lookup tables, how you can use them, how you can create them, how you can save them, and how you can, you know, how you can basically work with them. So I want to show you another way now. And I've got to say, I think this is possibly going to be one of my favorite ways of working it. Let me just get rid of these layers at the top here. Now, here in this particular group here called color grading, are the layers that go to make up the look, the final look on this picture. So if I just turn that on and off, you can see here what they're kind of doing to the picture. Now they're made up of a different kind of adjustment layers. Some of them being lookup table adjustment layers in the top right hand corner. There's also a gradient map in there as well. Now you can actually do the coloring. You can use any adjustments that you want to give the color that you'd like to have in your picture. Now before I was using lookup tables, but let me just show you a very quick and clever way that you can use a different thing. You can actually use your Creative Cloud library to do your color grading. Because although I kind of championed lookup tables, I had somebody post a comment this morning on my YouTube channel saying, is there any way when I've saved my own lookup table and then I use it, is there any way that I can make adjustments to the particular settings of all the layers that were in there? Well, the simple answer is no, if you do it as a lookup table, because it makes it on one particular layer. But I can show you how you can actually do it. Let's bring me back. There we go. Actually, that's probably too close. I can show you a different way that you can use it, but it is for those of you who are on the Creative Cloud only. So you've got Creative Cloud libraries. So over in the right-hand corner, we've got our libraries. Now, let me just go and create a new library. So create new library, and I'll call this color grading. So now I've got this one here. Now, here's the group that contains all my adjustments that I've done to give the particular color its look. So what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna click on that group and drag that entire group into my library. And you'll see now, it'll appear just up here in the top left-hand corner. So there now is my color grading. So let me show you how we can use this. I'll now delete the group. So we'll just imagine, for argument's sake, that I've now done lots and lots of retouching on this picture. And I'm now at the stage where I need to finish it all off and add that colouring. So I'm going to go to my Creative Cloud library, and here's my colour grading. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag it outwards and put it on top of my picture, like so. And then I'll press enter. But do you notice how nothing happens? Now that's intentional, nothing happens. When you look over in the layers panel now, we've got the color grading, and in the bottom right hand corner is like a cloud icon. It's almost like being a smart object, which is this kind of like a cloud object, and it kind of behaves the same. If I double click on it, it's going to open up in another window, and here is where I can see all those adjustments that we made on the picture. However, if I start to play around with these, how on earth do I know that's going to affect the picture? I can't really see it. I'm kind of working blind. So let me show you how you're going to do this. You're with me, right? You're with me. Right, so let's just delete that layer there. Now, you need to do one thing and one thing only. A little button on the keyboard will really help you out here. Now, instead of me dragging out that color grading and dropping it onto my picture, what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold down the Option key on Mac or the Alt key on PC, and then I'm going to drag it out and drop it on top of my picture. And watch what happens. Bang, there's the color. So the color's been added. But the bonus now is that over in the layers panel, I've now got all those adjustment layers back, so I can now dive in and make all the difference. This for me is definitely gonna be my number one way. I can save loads of different looks in my cloud library. They're gonna take up no space whatsoever because adjustment layers kind of got minimal sort of memory needed for those. So I can create loads of different looks and apply them quickly, dive into the adjustment layers and then fine tune them for when I apply them to different images. So that's a real quick one. Like I said, I only found that out last night. I hope you like that one. Let's just see, get some loving coming in the old comment section just there. Okay, cool. That's it, that's pretty much it. Let's just dive back over to here. Thief 40, 40% off. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in at this particular time. We've had some great numbers, so I'm really pleased with that. Hope that there was nothing too technically that played up for you. Hope the actual delay wasn't too bad. But thank you so much. Make sure, if you haven't already, you click to subscribe to my YouTube channel. I don't like the word subscribe. It should just say favorite the channel. Make it one of your favorites by clicking that subscribe button. That'd be great. Sign up to my email group. It's not a newsletter. Email group. And yeah, I shall see you around. I'll keep you updated with any more live broadcasts. But again, thanks very much. Have a good one and become a thief. Enjoy it. And now I'm going to try and turn this off. Here we go.